Tune in again for part two. Get ready.
Gut, drive, determination. The true story of Nick Dunn, surviving hell. 6 years falsely imprisoned in an Indian hellhole prison. Hold on tight because this one goes deep AF. It was an absolute honor to speak with Nick and to hear him so openly share a story about being in the Chennai Six, British soldiers falsely imprisoned for 6 years, and his road to recovery after being released. Author of the book, Surviving Hell, he openly states in this show that the one person who saved his life was his sister. And it's because of his friends and family that he's alive today, no longer suicidal and on a recovery journey from such an inhumane period of his life. The prison scarred him. This is clear to hear and see in Nick's emotional words and language. However, he is rekindling his pride and preciousness of life, and I'm proud to bring his experience to you all. Joining the British Army was a calling for him, and now after the depths of being weak, broken, and ashamed, he is using his gut, drive, and determination to claw his way back to a new chapter of his life, one with hope. Watching a strong man share his roller coaster journey with such openness can help us all to learn and grow. And I can tell you that I came away from this one with goosebumps and thankfulness. The Chennai Six were all British former soldiers traveling on an anti-piracy ship, the MV Seaman Guard Ohio. They were there to protect vessels against Somali pirates, but their real enemy turned out to be the Indian authorities, who trapped them for years in a legal nightmare. The men were falsely charged with intruding in Indian waters and the possession of illegal weapons. Nick lost 4 years of his life in India, the bulk of it in appalling conditions at Chennai prison. Despite this, he refused to buckle, and now he tells his full, inspiring story for the first time. You can find Nick's book on Amazon in the link down there. Surviving Hell, if you're listening, you want to punch into the search engine, and on Insta, and that link is in the show notes, but he's under Nick J. Dunn 86. Thanks for watching. Hi, I'm Damien Porter, former Special Forces operator, high performance living coach from hownottodie.com.au, and you can listen to my Straight Talk Mind and Muscle podcast, sponsored by realketonesaustralia.com, the best and most effective ketone supplement on the market to reduce anxiety, enhance brain performance, and supply twice as much energy as glucose. Thanks for watching.
And as time went by, you come down. You're not at that high anymore. You're coming right down back to reality, time of peace, getting right on with you. A new chapter has emerged in your life, but it's still following on. It's not a new book.
No.
It's just a new chapter.
Yeah.
And I didn't notice. It's always those around you notice first. And I notice things. And they're telling us, yeah. And I'm forgetting things. And I might have taken a wrong turn when I was driving my car.
Yeah. And you're not noticing, are you? Because your brain's not quite working that way.
But stolen my car, just trying to drive away, and just little silly things. But I like that, to where you don't notice. But then there was times where I'll be stood, and I'll be like, "I lost my car keys or something." Like, for an example, and it's like I'm going to a trance, and then I'll just come to. And I did this in my ex-partner, and she says, "Nick, what just happened there? You just froze with your head down." And I went, "No, I don't know," and then just cracked on, just palmed it off to one side, unaware of things. And the one person that saved my life, practically, I was pushing away, squabbling with my sister.
But we do that for some reason, don't we?
Yeah, it was like, cheers now, thanks. I've, I'm back home now, I don't need you. And my mind was just like, you know, and I was, but while that's happening, good things is happening. So that's why you don't really see it as much, because you're focusing on the good. And as the good's happening, you're becoming happier and comfort. You know, you're relaxing. And while you're heading in that direction, that is like a bad smell. It's like a shark smelling blood. It's coming. It's following you. And it just hits you. And I'm having premonitions of seeing my own death different ways. And it shits me up. I shake. I get that cool and cold shiver down my spine. And I'll be out in the public and I'll be just like, whoa, like, whoa, really thinking, why am I seeing this? Why am I seeing my fucking death before me in multiple ways? I'm seeing myself fall from a skyscraper. I'm like, what the hell?
Yeah.
Falling off a train, walking across a bridge. Next minute, I'm seeing myself jumping off the bridge. And I'm like, whoa, why? What's going on here?
Yeah. How is that mind playing that, those movies, yeah, when it's your mind?
And then when I came back home, when I like was having a bath and stuff like that, I put like soothing music and it was helping. And then I kind of went for a relationship breakup. And I think that was like the first trigger of the decline. It was the first ever kind of horrible breakup that I've experienced in my life. And I'm not saying that is the sole cause. That was
the cup overflows, the bucket overflows, didn't it?
Yeah, I think that was just that last bit of thing that just caused the water to flow, as you mentioned, over the bucket. And everything just started down, you know, just doing little mistakes, whether it was at work at the time and that job, or just, and you put yourself in a bad mood because you're trying to find out what the hell's going on, but you can't because you don't know yourself, and you're like, what? And your life just deteriorates. The good fortunate thing is I never turned to drink. And I do like a drink now and again. I had loads of alcohol to come home to, and my dad was just dripping. He was like, empty bottle, fresh. Empty bottle, fresh. He wouldn't give us them all together because they were not sure how I would have coped. Because my love for the gym keeps me going, I wouldn't have done that. But who was to know? I wasn't to know. If my dad just gave me all that drink, I could have just locked myself in the room and just gone like that. You don't know, but I'm quite confident I don't think I would have done that. But I'm like listening to this soothing music, and then I can't hear it anymore. All I can hear is my inner thoughts, my mind, planning, preparing in different various ways to take my own life. The demons had started to move in, so to speak. They started to colonize my thoughts, corrupt my soul. And if you were to have this conversation with me, or for me to watch myself explain my mental health 5, 7, 10 years ago, I'd have laughed at myself and gone, shut up, man. Don't talk wet. Don't talk daft. But I've experienced it, I've lived it, and I'm living through it. I don't see every day as a battle. I see them as little challenges. I can overcome that. Today's a good day. There might be a day I might not be able to overcome. I see it as a bad day, but not as a depressed, down day. You've got to try and find that balance in life, and that's a big, big rule for me. Try to find that balance. Everyone wants to be happy, You can't always be happy. There's no such thing as being happy. If you constantly are happy, people will think you're off your head on drugs.
It's funny
You've
you
got
say
to
that.
Find that balance.
It's funny you say that about happiness. And I'll just make sure we don't get into a technical difficulty here, like you started with. When someone else, that someone you love, is unhappy, you just want them to be happy.
Yes.
But you can't force someone to be happy. What I read a book, and it was a phenomenal book, and
I think we've lost signal. I've lost your voice. Your voice has gone off. I don't know if you can hear me. I can hear. I can still hear a noise, but not you. Feels like background noise, minus you talking.
Okay, Nick, have you got me on sound?
I've got you now.
All right. Ooh, technology. And today's post was, if it can go wrong, it will go wrong.
You always prepare for the worst. And if the worst doesn't happen, something good happens. Or you just have that mindset where it's not going to go wrong yet, but there's still time.
Awesome. So we'll cut that small bit out where it went, and I'm going to go back to where we were. It won't be a bother. It will be ironic. So we left off talking about happiness, and so often someone will see you when you're sad, Nick, and they go, what's wrong, and can you not just be happy? And we're looking at them, correct me if I'm wrong, looking like they just don't understand, they don't get it, they're speaking Swahili. But what I found was you can't choose happiness, but you can choose to be kind. And when I chose to be kind when I was coming out of those dark places, well, that's a really nice way to treat someone else, and you get it back, and it starts to get that forward momentum going as well. Would you? What do you think about that?
Oh, yeah, definitely. The times where I've been down and people say, oh, you're all right, I'm like, I might snap back at them.
Mm.
But then I've realised, oh, look, sorry for snapping at you. I'm just a bit under, you know, pressure, and I just feel not myself. I feel a bit. And I think the amount of times my sister's told me is, you've not really understood the trauma of what you've been through, because your mindset has only has been trained to experience physical trauma.
Mm.
Because when you're in the military and all that, that's the trauma you're more likely to experience. Even though mental trauma is 10 times worse, but when the brain is paining, who tells the brain to stop feeling pain? The brain can tell the muscles and the body to stop feeling pain, and that's where they are one, two total different experiences. And you've got to be happy. You've got to be that balanced in life, positive, but not doom and gloom. People will always mistake realism as negativity. They can't differentiate the two. There's been negative and there's been realist. There's been realistically saying, look, I just don't think I can handle this anymore. I'm going to seek help. Or that's it. It's over. Pass me the rope. They are two different examples of, you know, what people would say negativity. Yeah. But being a realistic person isn't negativity. It's just telling it how it is. And I think more people need to come out and just be raw. Don't sugarcoat shit. People don't want that. My personal experience of hell is totally different to someone else's. People might think, well, how can I take anything from this? You can take a hell of a lot and you implement it how you see fit in your struggles.
Exactly.
So my title of my book explains a lot. Surviving hell. Everyone sees hell as you go to hell, you don't survive. That is how we are programmed to think. No. No. It doesn't matter how many times them demons come for you. You raise your sword and shield and you fight back. But you can't do it alone. And I am a hypocrite. I would rather put my own self through pain and misery and make sure others are not. I'm dealing with a guy who's really finding it tough. And don't get me wrong, I don't reply straight away because I've got to be mind set for me to reply. Because how can you expect to help someone else when you're not or not feeling on your A game yourself. You're going to potentially say something that might be taken wrongly by him or her, and that could lead on to detrimental downpour of effects, and you don't want that. You want to try and say, look, and I will always defend myself when I say this. You need to find out what is causing you the negativity and remove it. And the harder thing is if it's a family member.
It is, isn't it?
Especially a direct family member. That's when it's difficult. But that's on a different scale. I'm on about trauma.
Yeah.
We all experience trauma in our different ways. The problem in society nowadays, yes, it's a big thing, mental health. It's an abused thing as well. And that doesn't sit well with me, because there's as many, if not more, people out there in the world scared to come out and talk, or they believe the system is going to fail them all the time because they are hearing the negative stories from people. Well, I've done this, I've done that, then nothing seems to be working. You can take a horse to water, but you can't force it to drink.
Exactly.
That's where you're going wrong.
Exactly.
I went really down. I didn't try to take me life, but I hit a bottom of rock bottom that I thought I would never experience. And I was thinking suicide. I was thinking, I can't deal with this. I've just gone through 4 years of hell, and now it just seems like it's not fucking ending. And it's becoming worse. But it didn't happen straight away. It was all nearly 3 years down the line. You know? Nearly 3 years after the end of the whole scenario. And you think, most people just think, oh, that's it. That's it. I'm down and depressed straight away after the trauma. It doesn't work like that. It might for some. For a lot, it doesn't, especially military, because we suppress things.
Well, can I just pause there or interject and add, in hopefully a good way? When you say military, the majority of that is males. Let's be realistic, because they're in the teeth arms. We can say those words, but for the listeners, the combat soldier, us men and strong men, they find it the hardest to seek help. They find it the hardest to put themselves first, because they like to put others first. So we're a bit of our own worst enemy there, aren't we, Nick?
Yes, and this is when I go back to me saying I am my own hypocrite.
Yeah.
I will always say, right, do this, do that, do the other. However, don't do what I did. I don't know if this is just me testing myself to see how far I can go. I don't know why I do it. I do not know. If I knew that, I'd deal with it. It'd be nipped in the bud. But that's not how it goes. That life's not Skittles falling from the sky as poisonous as rain. There's no rainbows. There's no unicorns. The world is how you see it. And if you see it doom and gloom, that's your world. If you see it as full of unicorns, that's your world. It ain't my world. My world's like that. I see good, I see bad, and I see the middle ground. And I want that middle ground, because in that middle ground, I can dictate my life how I see fit. That's my opinion. But when I start and feel down during that time, my family basically, if they could have knocked me out and threw me to the doctor, they would have done that. And it took courage. It took pride of being not just a man, but someone built and full of pride to admit he's weak He's ashamed, he's broken, and he needs help. That's how it affected me. I was at the bottom, but then when I realised why I'm at the bottom, I sunk even further because I've gone against everything that I stand for. I let a supernatural thing consume me. My pride was dented. I just was a wreck. I was like, this is not my life. What's going on? I need help. And you have to be willing to seek help. Family, friends, constantly, you need help, go get help. Push. That's what a lot of people do. That's the wrong attitude. They're not having to go at you because you've done something wrong. They're having to go at you because they fucking care about you.
Yep.
And they can see you deteriorate before their eyes. They see you with a fucking noose around your neck, waiting for that chair to be kicked away from you. That's how they vision you. But you can't see it. You can't see it. And you rebel. You give.
We fight. We fight and flight against it, don't we? Against them.
Yes, you do. And it feels like you're digging more soil and digging further into the bottomless pit. Mm. And I say this. You have to go through the pits of hell to see the light. And that's what we did. And that's what I do. I saw the light, at the most faint light. And I thought, in darkness, there is light. You just got to look for it. In every negative, there's a positive. You've just got to look for it. And that's when I thought, you know what? Let's do it. Let's take the help. I did talk and therapy, and I thought it was a real eye-opener. And I was able to just express myself. And for years, when I was younger, I used to build it up. And I used to punch walls and punch doors. I don't do that anymore. I've done for quite a number of years, because you realise walls and doors don't punch back, and you can't have that attitude because you could snap and take it out on someone. They'll punch back.
Mm.
So you've got to kind of get yourself out of that mindset. And like I say, I once took help. I was on medication. I know people have got to be on medication for probably a lifetime. They unfortunately have chemical imbalances that the tablets will never fix. They can just ease the pain slightly. And I believe you can be on tablets for a short term. And once you put your self right, you can ease yourself back off. But don't expect the road to be silky smooth straight away. You've got to get used to being in a different mindset, in a different type, kind of how you are compared to how you were.
I really like how you put that there, Nick.
You know, like, My ex-partner said to us, what would you be like if you saw a dead body these days? I said, I don't honestly know. I watch like gruesome films, and these days I kind of, not flinch, but I kind of squirm a bit.
Mm.
That's new. I never used to do that. I've seen dead bodies and whatnot. Doesn't bother me. But like I say, trauma will always leave its mark on you one way or the other. You will never be the same. No, I am still the same person who I am to my friends and family, but I'm not. because they can see the difference in me. I know there's a difference. I'm more emotional these days. I feel like I'm a woman on that period 24/7 at times. It's just so overwhelming. But you know what? I'm a man and I'm proud, and I'm rekindling me pride. It's restoring, because I've gone bump, and I've gone, you know what? The only way is up. How can you get lower than whale shit? You've got no choice, but you've got to go back up. So you start and build yourself back up, and things start going well. But you know, in the back of your mind, you're going to have another mishap. You just don't know when.
It's how not linear. That's when you're saying the road's not smooth. I've said that with a few guests. As males, we think, okay, we're going to go from point A to point B and it's going to go like that. But it's not linear, is it?
No, definitely not. In life, you know, we're always here, oh, how long, what did you do? Take the scenic route. Yeah. The hare and the tortoise.
Yeah.
Perfect example. We all want to get from A to B. There's being late and alive or dead on arrival.
Yeah.
Look at things like that. Everything we do say has a meaning of some sort. It's how you take it and the effect it has on you. And you know, time's getting on, and it was December last year, and I don't know, vaguely, I don't really recall myself being down in the dumps. Just stomach hitters. And I was in a previous job, and I just had a breakdown. I don't know what was the matter. Just, I was trying to do my job, and I couldn't. So I went and spoke to my supervisor. I said, can I have a private word here? And I just went, it just started again. And I said, look, I can't continue. I need to go home. I'm not. And I was like, look, I'm not, I don't care if you're a man or a woman. I'll be doing the exact same in front of a man.
Yeah.
So I hope you're not me trying to use, you know, women are more compassion than men tactics, because that was never in the forefront of my mind at all. I could have been talking to a brick wall. I would have been still in the same boat.
Yeah.
And then I crashed my car.
Oh, Jesus.
That wasn't my fault. A fucking deer ran out in front of us. But it was one thing leading on to another.
Exactly.
If my mind wasn't starting, could I have reacted a bit better? I never kind of looked at it. I just thought, oh, it's another, you know, things happen in threes kind of thing. And then nothing happened. I thought, oh, we've escaped that then. Two's better than three. Christmas comes. And I know I wasn't feeling too well, because I spent most of my day in bed on Christmas Day. My family wasn't happy, but they didn't realise, because I was masking it.
Yeah,
I just said,
yeah,
I was just on the drink and I was feeling hungover. Sorry. Do all the sorry, sorry, sorry. And then you put your mask on and then you put your smile on your face and you do it for your mum. Because even though my mum with a double aneurysm, she still can pick and sense things. And since I'm a baby, she knows. And I can't explain the stuff. My mum's not aware of this.
Yeah.
This is something I've not explained. So when my mum goes, what's the matter? I have to leave. Because she will just go at me like that.
Yeah.
to like a sergeant major, trying to find out what the hell you've done. And you're just like that. I can't deal with this, I'm away. And
the bandwidth just isn't there, is it, Nick?
No, I just don't want to put my man through it. No. So the best, how I think, is the best solution is to remove myself from the situation, which isn't the best situation because it makes my man more upset.
Yeah.
And then I get my sister on my case. Why is mom crying? What are you doing? I went, nothing. I don't know. Maybe I've, you know, it's just difficult. And then, like I say, we've moved on to this year. And like I say, I'm kind of just trying to find my way into the new year. And January is a bit of a difficult month. And then the 1st of February, chatting to the phone to my friend. And this is what, this it doesn't piss me off. It just grates on me. Because everyone seems to doctor in it. If you're feeling down, picking up the phone, blah, blah, blah. It doesn't work like that.
No.
It doesn't. Trust me. It might for some. For me, it didn't. I was on the phone to my friend. We ended the call. That was it. The demons have got me. Full blown. They consumed me. I became a robot. I wasn't in control of myself, but I was. I knew. I could think I could see myself doing everything I didn't want me to do.
Yeah.
And that's when I decided to try and take my own life. I had no control of, I didn't even know from me lying in the baths and having premonitions and visualizing, planning, executing. Nothing in life seems to go to plan at times. And even trying to take my own life didn't even go to plan. And I can laugh about it now because I see it in two different ways. I see it as my heart, my soul overcome it. It wasn't my time. And then on the flip side, I see myself, I can't even fucking kill myself. I'm a fucking failure. And that hit me pride even more.
Mm.
So I had these, I was getting pains and I got some painkillers from my mum, some very strong ones. I can't even pronounce the name. You always know when something's strong that you can't pronounce it. And I had about 60 of them off the belt. Just went like that, water. Wasn't even in control. And then I was just sat there in my bed and that's where that. And after the previous incident, when I go quiet, that kind of worries my family.
Yeah.
So I'd been quiet. And that's when they kind of were ringing us and they could hear me slurring on the phone. And then my sister went into panic mode. And next minute, my dad's at my house. I'm sparkled on my bed, probably in and out of consciousness, slurring. And I can't move my body, but I can. It's like my brain is alive, but my body's dead. And I can hear my dad in hysterics trying to speak with the emergency services on the phone, and they're saying, "Oh, we'll be an hour." And he's like, "An hour? He could be freaking dead in an hour. I'll take him myself." You know, and they're like, "We don't believe you can get to the hospital in less than an hour." He says, "Well, only 15 minutes drive away, man." And honestly, the time he was kind of trying to, because my body was lifeless. There was no control. And my dad's 76.
Oh.
And I live in an upstairs flat.
And you're a big lad as well.
So for my dad to try and lift me off my bed, to try and help me without falling down the stairs, he literally got us in the car. As he was putting me left leg in, the ambulance came screeching round the corner. And then they transferred me back into the ambulance. And then obviously we went on the blues and twos to the hospital. And obviously this was in the morning. And I didn't get out of the hospital till like nearly 12 o'clock at night, because they had to do blood tests because of what I took, just to make sure that there wasn't any internal organ damage. And I tell you what, coming home was like a gentle reminder that life is precious. You only have one. It doesn't matter how hard life is, you've got to keep going forward towards the light. There's many days where I don't want to be here. There's many days I feel so fucking painful that I can't describe it with words. But you know what? I see my friends, I see my family, and I'm here because of them. They could have gave up on me, but they didn't. So why should I give up on them? You know, and it upsets me. It hurts, because I never thought that I would ever experience anything like this. I always had this, I'm invincible. I was a parachute regiment soldier, for God's sake. And I just feel like my pride, it just fucking destroyed. You know? And that's what I was feeling. And I was saying to myself, I'm better than this. Life isn't happy all the time. It's not sad either. It's what you make of it. And that's the best way to look at life. If your life's feel so hard, try and find the reason behind it. We're all going through difficult times. Currently, previously, potentially in the future. But how you deal with it, you've got to get yourself in that mindset. You've got to find out what's causing the negative. You've got to just bear with things.
I understand what you mean now, Nick, about being in the middle ground. You said it about 30 minutes ago, just before we had the technical difficulty, and around that time as well. You know, you got happy, sad, but you're sort of searching for that middle ground. And now you've contextualized it so well. I've never had you like it. That middle ground actually seems like where we're supposed to be. I can only liken it to highs and lows, probably the same thing in a different language. And we actually want to be in that average, in that normal space. Yeah. But Jesus, I've never had a guest so open and sharing like yourself. Life is precious. You said it there. And what a great mindset you've got. You know, I'm here because of friends and family.
Oh, Tom Dale.
That's right. We'll work through that one as well.
I don't know what's happened. My screen's gone.
Just lost the video, mate. Just lost your video.
2 seconds.
That's all right. Here we go. You know.
There we go.
So I was just saying then, you know, what your mindset is saying, I'm here because of my friends and family. Why don't I pay it back for the, you didn't say that exactly, but you know, you should pay them respect back that you're an honorable man is what I'm getting. I try to unpack and try and maybe reword some of the stuff you talked about, pride and so on, but honor, you know, you're honoring your family, you're honoring your friends, you're honoring human life, your own life. And again, that's so tough for us to do as males. We put ourselves last. So, wow, I'm just blown away at your journey, my friend.
Yeah, but we live in a different time now. It's not to be looked upon as being weak. I know I do mention, this is why I say it. This is me. Don't do what I do, this, but do what I suggest you do. And whatever, you can take my advice. You can pay someone else to have their advice. Mine's free. I don't care. But I just will try to help others. I deal with me. I'm openly a hypocrite when on that subject. Because I battle my demons in the way I battle them. And I, like I said, mentioned earlier, I'm there with my sword and I'm there with my shield. And I will go toe to toe. But I might lose battles. But the war is long and tiring. But there is breaks in that war where we have to regroup. Even the demon has to regroup.
Yeah.
Because there is days where you are so powerful, so full of pride, so happy within yourself because things around you, is you're sucking that energy in. Even the demons have to go and regroup. That's why I say every day is a different day for trauma sufferers. There is them little things that brings back the memories. Like, I don't have nightmares of being in prison. I could happily, easily watch these prison programs where they show the real life. And I've had, like, my ex-partner say, I really want to watch these, like, these different prisons around the world. Are you okay to watch it? Will it affect you in any way, shape, or form? I went, no, I'm just hoping there's a prison in India so I can kind of, you can open your eyes to something similar to what I was going through, because I had a lot of people say to me, oh, Nick, are you exaggerating things? And this, that, and you. I went, trust me, I don't have to exaggerate nothing. I'm telling it how it is.
Yeah.
And they're like, is that what it was like? And I'm like, yes, he has the pictures. My sister sent us a spy pen. I went around taking pictures. And they're on my social media. They are legitimate. They are the pictures I've taken. Yes, on a few of the pictures, the date's wrong, but my sister wasn't aware that there would be a date. She just charged it up. Put it in notepad, envelopes, other bits and bobs, disguised it, posted it out to us, hoped for the best.
Brilliant.
And obviously, I took it upon myself. And it wasn't until I released my book, that's when I released the photos. So people could kind of read my book. And then if they couldn't visualize there with their own thoughts, then they can use my pictures to then put two and two together, and it will enhance the reader, as in they'll be able to go, you know what, he's, from what he's writing about to the pictures he's put, yeah, I definitely can relate and feel for what he went through with the other guys, because it was horrendous. It was like torture, the heat, you know, they would lie to you saying that there's outside problem and the power would be off for nearly 12 hours. And you're in the summer, it got to nearly 50 degrees 1 year. And inside, it was like 40. And you just were like, can't survive this. You keep going.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's the thing about us as humans. We sink or swim.
I'm not the best of swimmers, but I tell you what, I'll doggy paddle till I drown. That's how my mentality. I will always push myself and I will always go in that direction towards the light. I might complain and whinge and moan, but that's me being realistic. That's not me being doom and gloom.
Nick, I'd like to, you've sort of summarized it yourself really well. But I'd like to just touch on the brain. You talked about mental health, you talked about, you're really saying you needed help and things like that. But just generalizing as males, and maybe generalizing as mental health, we're very good at going, okay, I've got an injury, I've damaged the joint, I've done this, that means I've got to go and do this. But the brain, we're not used to seeing, please correct me if I'm wrong, we're not used to seeing, identifying what that actually looks like. We can see that person's got a limp, we see I've got pain in my back, but we can't quite identify it in ourselves, and it's so confusing. Is that sort of a fair account of mental illness or something not being right in the brain? And then also the positive side of it, then if you do identify it, it's something we can actually fix. Would that be a fair sort of picture?
I think it's such a complex thing, the brain.
Right.
I don't think they realize that a lot of it is guesswork and a lot of it is pretty good guesswork. But I think it's our motherboard. So picture yourself as a machine.
Great.
Our brain's our motherboard. If that doesn't function properly, the rest of us don't function, and it'll send signals to wherever we're feeling that pain, and we will think of how to describe this pain, and can this pain be can it be threat, yes or no, and that's how you differentiate things. A lot of the times they will just chuck antidepressants like that Smarties. And I'm thinking, that's not a cure. It's just a prevention, but it's not even a good prevention. I'm not saying no one should take any medication. I'm not saying that at all. But you need to get a diagnostics done in
Yes.
that person. You need to get in the head. You as a like a doctor or a mental health practitioner kind of, they need to get in your head. They need to find the root of the problem. So when I was doing my talking therapy, yes, it was only 12 weeks. In that time and that period, it worked. It just unfortunately, other things must have happened, and that must have wore off for then my decline to then for me to then try and take my life. But it worked. So things are working, things are getting better. The medication's probably getting better, but you still have to do the learning. You still have to think and not always go, oh, it's the obvious. That's the problem. We always think, oh, it's the obvious. And guess what? It's completely the opposite. But a lot of people don't express their feelings because they're shy, they're scared. So if you're a doctor and you're trying to find out what the problem is with your patient, and they're not doing enough of this, then you're stumped. You're trying to have to try things, and you could be go like a dog chasing its tail.
Yeah, no
That's why
diagnostic
I
package either.
urge people, talk, speak. And I don't do these social media posts and go, oh, if anyone's at my door, it is. You should know that by now. People should know that by now, how honest and open I am when I talk about it. You can message me. But be patient, because if I'm not up to the task, it's because I'm not feeling good. But don't get angry at me, because I will just completely fuck you off, because you're going to then infect me to make me harder, then get back up there because I can't help you. That doesn't work like that. If we all want to try and help each other, but sometimes you've got to help yourself.
Put that mask that on first. Put the oxygen mask on first when you're in the crash.
Everyone wants their arse wiped in life, but unfortunately, there's not all that many hands that are willing to wipe someone's arse. You've got to do it yourself, unfortunately. And I tell you what, you can feel 10 times more pride knowing you've done it yourself with the help. Never do it on alone. I made that mistake. And I honestly will say that. I pushed things away. I'm all right. I'm all right. I'm all right. I'm all right. My family can tell me he's about to fucking self-destruct. Then stay away. He has to find it out the hard way. That was what I did. Because my pride overpowered my thoughts. That's why when I refer, my pride's been dented. Because the second time, that my pride couldn't deflect. That got smashed. That's when I thought, you know what? I have to take that next step. I need help.
Nick, do you think, I mean, it's been amazing and humbling to share your journey here. And really, I thought it was, the direction was going to be your experience in jail, your experience of leading up to it, and what happened and surviving hell. And we're going to look at mental health side of things. But really, we talked about your journey through the 5 years past. It's been absolutely phenomenal. I never really said this in a show, but I think you should. But have you thought about writing another book or putting these towards another book when you're on the other side of it all, of that new journey, that new hell you've seen?
I've never thought about it. I've had a few people mention, you know, you should, like, you've done the surviving hell, but you're not out of hell yet.
It's just an idea. I agree with them 100%.
You're in a lighter environment, but it's still difficult. Like I say, there's many battles in a war.
Yeah.
The war will always be long and painfully enduring, but there's always breaks in them wars where there's downtime. You could call it peacetime, but we're never at peace. We're always fighting against ourselves. We're always trying to better ourselves. We're always criticizing ourselves. And I'm a bad critic. I will always criticize myself. And the problem is, when you get someone else who criticizes you, people take it to heart even more.
It cuts deep, doesn't it? Yeah.
And you need to take criticism, but you need to differentiate of someone criticizing you, but giving you reason why, or someone just being blatantly fucking nasty.
Yeah.
Exactly. Bringing you down.
Exactly.
Because their life is shit and they want everyone around them to feel shit too. They're the people who are like the bottom feeders of life. Get rid of them.
Yeah, cut them away.
And you can't always be running around with a smile on my face, but we can feel happy. People say you've got one of those faces, Nick. We can't tell what you're feeling. I said, emotionless. What do you want us to? You want us to just be jumping around doing cartwheels? I went, I'm just chilling. But yeah, you've got that face. And the good thing is the eyes. Like, I've seen people comment from one video to the next. And when I came out and I told people what I'd done, and I wasn't saying this for likes or fucking shit like that, I was just saying it as, this is an experience for me, a new experience for me, and hopefully people could take something from my experience and implement it in their lives, their struggles, and hopefully it helps them. That's my goal. And they were like, I looked in your eyes and I saw emptiness. But then they saw another video later on and they could start to see the sparkle come back. So it does take time. It takes like that to go wrong, but it takes time to get better. And everything's a process in life. We all have to take our time. It'll happen when it happens. It's like looking for a lovely woman that you want to spend the rest of your life with. You'll constantly be looking, and you'll meet women, but it won't work out. And you bring yourself down. You think, oh, to hell with women. I'm not interested, blah, blah, blah. And then you're just getting on by, and then what's happened to you? And that happened to me.
Brilliant.
And she asked us this. She said that like yesterday, she went, because she's just off her. She's just funny. Bless her. And she had a blocked nose and she's walking around with an inhaler constantly stuck up her nose out because she's never used one before. And I was just like, oh, what are you doing, you idiot? I can't breathe. And then she just came out and she went, what were you doing before you met me? I went, trying to kill myself. And her face just changed. I went, but I was. And then I met you and the clouds started to shift and the sun started to come out.
Wow.
Yes, going into another relationship when I had no intentions of being in a relationship because I was just bloody crawling back from nearly killing myself.
Yeah.
That's not what I had intentions, but things happen for a reason.
And you don't get to choose when it happens.
And that's where happiness comes from. You can't search for happiness.
No.
Happiness finds you. That's what I believe anyways.
Wow. Wow. I can't believe I'm an interviewer. I mean, I'm an operator, I'm a fireman, and you know, I'm trying to hold it all together, all these notes and shape the direction of the interview, but you've blown my mind. I've interviewed a few cats before, man. Thank you.
Tell it how it is.
Exactly. You just laid it out. Thank you for sharing your story. Thank you for being so open to help others by sharing your story, and I just wish you all the best. If there's anything I could ever do to support you in any way, obviously I'll do the preview here, and we'll everybody who's listened to now, which is going to be a two-part story, is going to know exactly where to find the book. I'll be getting one after this. I'm going to order that online.
Amazon is normally the best.
I love it. I'll take a photo. Beautiful. I'm looking forward to the sequel. I'm looking forward to the classic hero's journey, which you're clearly on. There'll never be an ending, obviously, Nick, but just to watch your journey and watch the next pinnacle of what you achieve.
As time, it does get easier. I've just got to realise it's only been 5 years.
Exactly.
And it's just like what my sister said. You've never understood what you've actually been through. You've never literally sat down with yourself and gone, I've just gone through fucking hell here. Mm. I've just had 4 years of just mental anguish. Mm. Constantly boom, 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 boom. So much pain. So much suffering, but you know what? I survived.
Exactly.
We all can survive if we put our heart, soul, and mind to it and have a good support network. Can never do things alone. I certainly couldn't. I wanted to throw my towel in so many times, but my sister just went, "You can have that back."
She
No,
sounds
I was
like a great
having.
woman.
He's actually from Newcastle, but he lives in Marrickville in Australia. So it was nice for him to contact me and get in touch and start writing letters to me. People in America, Canada, around the world, Europe, obviously predominantly in the UK, writing to me in prison. And I'm reading these letters, seeing them come with that foreign stamp on, and I'm like, this is real, this is a real, you know, and reading their encouragement. If that doesn't bring something to you to fight, I don't know what is. If you can't take that and put it there to restore energy to get you to fight, like, I'll just, like I say, finish this. My sister always used to come and visit me in prison around my birthday at the beginning of March. And the last year we were in prison, she brought me dad, because I literally said, I need to see him. I can't see my mum. My dad's 70-odd year old. You know, what if something happens and I'm in prison? That'll be it. I'll just... And she says, I don't know, I don't know. And she brought him out. And I'll tell you what, he got me his being in that prison alongside with my sister was that extra vital energy I needed. Because the energy that my sister brought us, I don't think would have been enough. I was literally, that's it, game over. But he came with my sister, and you know what? Boom. Come on, let's go to the finish line. And I did. I went to the finish line, and the day we got released, the day we got the good news from the court, to the few days pissing about with the authorities, with the visas, it was their last wave knocking were about,
spite.
To getting on the plane, to arriving home. I remember it crystal clear. We all remember certain events like they happened the day before in our lives. It's just, you watch the video, you can easily find it online, the video of me coming home. Powerful emotion. What it means to a family who have seen their loved one for the first time as a whole in 4 years. And I go, it's only 4 years. I tell you what, that's 4 years of my life I'll never get back.
Exactly.
That I wrongly lost, the injustice that was served upon me and my comrades, my colleagues. For what? What outcome? Nothing.
Exactly. Exactly. You know, 4 years, and I talked about
this. See, I'm here. And life's good. I'm a lot happier than I was.
Just amazing to hear what you've come through. You know, I hark back to, an Australian Special Air Service operator could barely handle 28 days and you did 4 years. It's just a testament to where you're at. I always say in a show, no matter what it is, if this can help one person with one thing they've heard in the show, we've done our job. And yours is literally 2 hours of a phenomenal, mind-blowing interview. Nick, Thank you so much for your time. I'm absolutely stunned. And
thank you so much
wish you
for
all
inviting
the
me here.
best.
It's a pleasure. Thank you so much.
You're most welcome.
Hi, thanks for watching. I'm Damien Porter, former Special Forces operator, and check out my new project for 2023 at hownottodie.com.au, where I've combined all my Special Forces training and police officer experience to help others. Thanks for watching.